和大家在红酒世界的直播平台上见面了。今天我们很高兴再次邀请到李智彦大师和我们一起分享葡萄酒的那些事。那李智彦大师呢，是亚洲首位葡萄酒大师。那在之前的直播呢，他和我们一同分享了有关于如何定义一瓶好酒，以及2015年波尔多七酒的一些知识和内容。今天我们很高兴邀请到李大师为我们介绍这个有关于美国加利福尼亚州以及纳帕谷葡萄酒的一些内容。那话不多说，我们现在立刻进入主题。
Thank you, Jasmine. I think this is a great opportunity today to talk about both California wines and also Napa Valley specifically, because it's such an exciting time. You can see that from the exports from Napa Valley as well as California, it's growing at a tremendous speed, especially in the last 10 to 20 years. And we have a selection of 6 different wines from California and Napa Valley to see what they're like and to talk a little bit more in depth about what this region makes, you know, such amazing wines and makes such unique styles.
那今天很高兴和大家一同分享有关于这个加州以及纳帕谷葡萄酒的一些内容。那其实大家会很关注纳帕谷的一些事情，因为在过去的10年到20年中，它的这个葡萄酒的出口速度呢迅猛增长。那在今天我们会精心选6款葡萄酒是来自美国加州和这个当地的纳帕谷地区的。那在这个直播的过程中，我们也会跟大家分享为什么纳帕谷这个地方可以生产出优质的葡萄酒。
So if we look back about 150 years ago, this is when the first pioneers of California wines really settled in. You're talking about people like Gustav Niebaum, Jacob Berenger, Charles Krug. These are the pioneers from the 1800s who settled and really wanted to make quality wines.
Mm-hmm. 那其实纳帕谷这个葡萄酒历史可以追溯到150多年前了。那我们要说起纳帕谷这个葡萄酒的先驱者呢，就要提到几个重要的人物，一个是查尔斯·库克，还有一个是古斯塔夫·尼伯姆。那这些人呢，就是希望在纳帕谷这个地方也能酿造出同他们的故乡一样的高品质的葡萄酒。
Napa faced a lot of challenges. The first challenge really came in the form of phylloxera, the aphids that were vine-eating and basically destroyed the vineyards. And this happened in France, moved to throughout North America, and pretty much all the vineyards in California had to be planted in the late 1800s and the turn of the century, 1900.
Mm-hmm. 那其实在纳帕谷这个地方，他要想种植葡萄呢也并不是这么容易的，他也面临了很多挑战。那其中一个主要挑战呢是来自于这个 phylloxera， 就是这个根瘤蚜虫。那当时呢，这个根瘤蚜虫从这个法国传到了北美，毁坏了当时很多的葡萄园，因此这个根瘤蚜虫命害对当时的葡萄园是一个非常致命的打击。
So then we had after that periodThe 1920, which was devastating for the vineyards, which was a man-made, not a natural disaster, which was called Prohibition. So for 13 years, from 1920 to 1933, the government prohibited the sale and the making of alcohol, and you could only make it if it was for religious purposes. So almost all the wineries shut down.And this was a very, very devastating period where the industry shrank.
那第二个重要挑战呢，是大家可能或许会知道这个法国的禁酒令。那这个时间是1920年至1932年，持续了1933年持续了13年的时间。那其实这个是因为当时的美国政府发布了这个禁酒令，它禁止这个。买卖和这个制作葡萄酒，而当时的葡萄酒仅是供宗教的用途来去制作。那当时呢，这个法令对当时很多的葡萄酒和酒庄的这个影响也是非常大的。
So after prohibition was repealed in 1933.And the wine industry started to grow again. You had World War II, which ended in 1945. So it was really not until the 60s and 70s where the modern California wine industry and Napa's industry really started to grow.
那也就是在这个禁令结束之后，也就是1933年之后，这个纳帕谷的葡萄酒行业才渐渐的兴起，也是到上个世纪六七十年代，我们这个纳帕谷才真正开始走向黄金时期。
So the style prior to 1960s that was made in California was really fortified wines and sweet. So this was not your premium dry wines as we know it now.And it was really 1960s and onwards with pioneers like Robert Mondavi, who then started to create premium wines that were dry and with a style using Cabernet Vitis vinifera grapes that made it recognizable and what we know now.
那其实在60年代的葡萄酒，当时的葡萄酒的风格呢是比较强劲，而且偏甜的，并不是我们今天所熟知的风格。直到后来是由那个纳帕谷的这个葡萄酒行业是在这个蒙大维家族的带领之下，才逐渐发展成我们今天比较能够接受的一个葡萄酒的风格。那今天这个纳帕谷的葡萄酒的风格呢，也得到了世界各地的认可。
So what makes Napa as famous as it is now. It's really because of one specific tasting that occurred in 1976 in Paris. This was organized by a very good friend of mine, Stephen Spurrier, who, you know, went on to do many such comparative blind tastings. And it was taking 10 wines, 10 reds, Cabernet-based, and 10 whites, Chardonnay-based,and tasting them blind. So he got some of the best producers from the 1970s, both in Napa Valley and the top wines of Bordeaux, as well as the top white Burgundies, and tasted these blinds with top tasters, mostly in France. French tasters in Paris.
Okay. 那其实要说到纳帕谷真正走向辉煌的一个转折点，很重要是1976年的巴黎审判这个盲品会。那当时这个盲品呢是一位叫 Steven 的法国人举办的，当时就选举了十款勃艮第和十款这个波尔多的十款波尔多红葡萄酒和十款勃艮第白葡萄酒进行品鉴的。那当时请到了非常多专业的品酒人士，还有葡萄酒界的权威人士，在这个品鉴会上进行盲品。
And the judges included some really renowned winemakers and owners, such as Aubert de Villain from Domaine de la Romanée Conti, DRC. And he was among the judges. Everything was tasted blind. And what a surprise when in the Cabernet, the 10 red wines, the top wine was Stag's Leap.
Okay, 那其实当时呢，这个品鉴会的这个裁判呢是来自这个法国的罗曼·罗康蒂的这个庄主，那他是作为一个专业的舌头去品鉴这些葡萄酒，那结果出人意料的是，在这十款的葡萄酒当中，得分最高的是当时位于美国加州的这个陆月酒庄的红葡萄酒。
So even in the white wine blind tasting, the wine they came up on top, beating a lot of Grand Crus and beating wines like Domaine La Fleuve, very well known and highly regarded, was a Napa Valley white. It was the Montalena Chardonnay that became number one. So you had both the top red and the top white was a Napa red and white.
Okay. Not...白葡萄酒的评判结果也是一样的，它是它这款评分最高的这款白葡萄酒呢，是来自于纳帕谷的一所叫做蒙特莱纳酒庄的霞多丽干白葡萄酒，也是打败了很多这个当时波尔多的劣迹庄的白葡萄酒。所以我们现在可以看到，这个1976年这个巴黎审判的盲品会上，红和白葡萄酒的最高分呢，都是来自于这个纳帕谷酒庄的葡萄酒。
Now, we can't underestimate the impact of this tasting, because after this tasting was conducted, it was published in many publications, including Time magazine. And what people felt in California was this amazing sense of pride. They had just started really serious premium winemaking since the 60s, and in the 70s already, they were being recognized and even beating some of the top wines, the top first growths like Chateau Mouton Rothschild or Aubryon. And to have it come up on top was completely, really just an encouraging first push. And this made a lot of people go into the wine industry. And starting from the 70s, you see a lot of investment both in Napa Valley as well as the rest of California.
Mm-hmm. 那我们可想而知在这个巴黎审判之后这个影响是非常大的因为当时的这个盲品的结果被刊登在各大的这个出刊物上 包括当时的这个Times这个时代周刊 那当时这个结果是让所有人都吃了一大惊 那也就是说 60年代起纳帕谷开始酿造葡萄酒 那70年代他们的这个葡萄酒就 为所有人都知道了，所以呢，当时在70年代之后，这个纳帕谷的葡萄酒就开始进入了一个腾飞的状态。那当时就很多人在这个地方投资，不仅是在纳帕谷地区，也在整个加州也开始有投资葡萄酒行业。So
we can see 1976 is kind of the birth date of premium Napa wines and premium Californian wines. And then since the 80s, things moved very, very quickly. In 1981, Napa Valley became the first AVA, which is the same as the Bordeaux Appellation system, where they identified regions that could be called Napa Valley. They drew the boundaries and wrote the geography so that people were very clear that they can trust the bottle. When it says it comes from a certain region, then they know that it signifies the specific boundary of the land.
那所以呢，这个纳帕谷的葡萄酒真正开始腾飞呢，我们可以从这个1976年东京 巴黎审判这个地方可以算起，那其实到进到80年代的时候，这个地方的葡萄酒的发展速度也是相当快的。当时在1981年的时候，这个纳帕谷呢，被认定为是法国第一个这个法定的葡萄产区，那就像是波尔多的这个法定产区一样，它会根据不同的这个地理位置，然后划分一个纳帕谷产区的一个 那个法定的葡萄产区，那也会将这些产区的名字标注在这个葡萄酒的酒标上，让人们就可以从我们葡萄酒的酒标中就能识别得出这款酒是出自纳帕谷。So
let's go specifically into what makes Napa Valley so unique. The first reason is really because it's a pretty small geographical area, but it makes a really big impact.
那我们会 仔细地聊聊纳帕谷的这个产区里面的一些具体的内容。首先要强调的一点是，这个纳帕谷其实是一个非常小的地方。So
how small is Napa Valley? Well, it's only 4% of all of Californian wine. And we know that about 90% of all wines made in the United States are from California. So California as a state is huge, almost like a country. When you look at the size, it's about 3/4 of France. That's how big California is. And it makes up most of the wine. And Napa is tiny, only 4% of that total.
那其实这到底是有这个纳帕谷它到底是有多小呢？首先，我们来看一下这组数据。我们知道，其实这个加州是非常大的一个地方。那它的面积相当是一个国家，基本是相当于1/4的葡萄酒都是出自于加州。而纳帕产区的葡萄酒的产量仅占是整个加州的4%。And
if you look at the world of wine, Napa makes only 0.04% of the production. It's tiny. And these are made up mostly of family-owned properties.
Okay.
So you see, around 95% of the wineries in Napa Valley are actually still family-owned.
那如果我们放眼全球的话，这个数据会更加小。那纳帕谷每年的葡萄酒产量仅占世界 葡萄酒产量的0.04%，那其实在这个地方呢，95%的酒庄都为家庭经营式的小型酒庄。
Yeah, and if you compare it with Bordeaux, because often Napa Valley Cabernets are compared with Bordeaux, you see that especially on the left bank, with the big chateaus, Chateau Lynchbage or Chateau Pichon Lalande, they're making around 20,000 to 30,000 cases per year. Mm-hmm. And you see that in Napa Valley, it's actually very different, because the vast majority make less than 10,000 cases a year. Mm-hmm.
那其实我们谈到纳帕的时候，我们就会对比这个波尔多，因为两者都是在赤霞珠，这个赤霞珠的这个葡萄都是非常优质的。那我们可以再看这样的数据，特别是在法国波尔多的左岸，它那个一级庄，它的产量呢，就是有名的酒庄，它的产量是大概在两到三万箱每年，而在纳帕谷的这些小型酒庄中，他们每年的产量可能不足，或是约一万箱左右。
But you can see the impact is big because everybody knows Napa Valley wines. And if you ask people what region in California would you like to visit, most people will say Napa Valley. And they contribute, Napa Valley as a region contributes around $13 billion to the economy.And they employ about 46,000 people.
那可以看到，那这个纳帕谷的葡萄酒行业呢，对当地是有非常大的影响的。如果你问一个美国人说你要想去在加州的哪个地方旅行，他们一定会说 Napa Valley， 纳帕谷。那其实纳帕的这个葡萄酒行业为当地产生了约$130 million的经济效益，为46,000人创造了工作岗位。
The top grape varieties I think most people are familiar is Cabernet Sauvignon. Mm-hmm. And with Cabernet, they won the 1976 Paris tasting, and they continue to impress people around the world with its very unique style. Mm-hmm. We're going to be tasting two of them today.
Mm-hmm. 当地呢比较有名的，就像我们刚才所有名的葡萄酒呢，就像我们刚才所说的是这个赤霞珠红葡萄酒。那不仅是在1976年的这个盲品会上，赤霞珠惊艳了全球，直到今天，它的独特风格仍然是为世人所接受。
And along with Cabernet, whenever you find Cabernet in the world, you often find Merlot and also Cabernet Franc. And in California, you also find Petite Syrah.Syrah, as well as Cabernet Franc.
那如果我们就是说到赤霞珠的时候，一定是离不开谈到梅洛的。那在加州这个地方，梅洛也是有一定的种植量的。那当然，在加州我们同时还有这个希拉和小希拉。
So you see among the white wines too, you find a lot of Chardonnay and so Sauvignon Blanc, which they do in a very unique and special style.
那这个白葡萄。品种呢有包括霞多丽和这个长相思，长相思的风格在当地来说是非常独特的。
So all these grape varieties are possible in a small region like Napa Valley because of the diversity of the soil and the climate. So that is the unique point about Napa Valley is how the geography is so different from anywhere else in the world.
那其实为什么纳帕谷会有这么多种多样的葡萄品种呢？是因为当地的无论是土壤还是气候都是非常的多样化的。这也就是为什么这个纳帕谷的这个葡萄酒能够如此的独特原因。
You see that as soon as you drive down Highway 29, which goes right into the heart of Napa Valley, and you drive south to north, going up to Mount Helena and Calistoga.You pass through so many different mountain and hill ranges on both sides, and you also have the valley floor. And this is because 150 million years ago, you had the shifting of the tectonic plates, which brought up volcanoes, riverbeds, and it rose from the surface, creating this amazing soil composition. So Napa has over 100 different types of soil combinations.
那其实呢，如果你在这个纳帕谷这边旅游的话，从南至北呢，你会注意到它两边的这个景致是完全不一样的，会有山地、丘陵，也会有这种谷地的这种景致。这是因为在很久很久以前，这个地质运动所造成的现在的自然景观的生成。那当时的太平洋板块的下沉，抬升了陆地板块。那这个时候就会从这个地表的深层呢，喷射出这个熔岩，那这导致的结果就是这个熔岩喷洒在我们的这个陆地的板块上。那现在呢，这个纳帕谷的土壤就非常的多样化，有大概100多种土壤。
So when you drive through Napa Valley, you'll see that on your western part, on the western part closer to the Pacific Ocean, you have the Mayacamas mountain range. And then on the eastern part, you have the Vaca mountain range. So everywhere around you are hillsides. And what hillsides means is that not only different soils, they can be hard, more volcanic, darker, deep, bedrock almost, to rich, more fertile soils on the valley floor. But you also have different altitude, which mm-hmm. gives you different growing conditions, and as different as 10 degrees in variation from the valley floor to the different altitudes in the mountains and hills.
那这个纳帕谷呢，在东岸和在它的西岸和东侧呢，分别有两个非常重要的山脉，一个就是马卡梅亚斯山脉，也就是东边的这个瓦卡山脉。那这两个山脉呢，你会注意到它们的当地的土壤的组成是不同的，有这个火山石。那同样在当地的这个地势高低起伏会不平，那它的这个海拔也会有所不同。
So you have all these different climates, different altitudes, and then you have the influence of the fog.Which can really bring down temperatures. And different combinations of whether you're in the northern valley or the southern valley, different altitudes in mountains, and really even different rain. So rain influences, because the mountains can have more rain one year and less in the valley, and then the reverse in another year. So you have all these mesoclimate influences, which makes a big difference.
那除了我们刚才说到这个地势和天气的影响，那当然还有这个纳帕谷这个晨雾的影响，也会将当地的一个温度保持在一个较低的水平当中。而且呢，纳帕谷的降雨量在各个地区有非常的不同，比如说山地和这个峡谷，可能今年山地的雨多，然后峡谷的这个雨少，那明年这个情况可能又会有一个反转。
So Jasmine, we've gone through the climate very briefly. It's a Mediterranean climate mm-hmm. and some of the soil mm-hmm. and the styles. I'm sure that there are some questions that the audience may have.
I'm sure they do. So I will check. 那现在呢，因为我们已经给大家做了一个简单的有关纳帕谷的介绍，相信各位也有一些问题。现在呢，我们会从大家的问题当中挑选一些，让我们大师来做回答。有一位这个观众很感兴趣的是，他希望知道是纳帕谷的葡萄酒有哪些经典的风格。So one of our audience asks, what are the typical times of the styles of the wines in Napa Valley?
Well, the styles range by quite a lot, because as you'll see when we do our tasting, you can get Sauvignon Blanc that's very herbal and citrusy, and light-bodied, and then you can get fuller-bodied white wine styles, lots of Chardonnay that could be tropical fruity and bright and big. You also get Pinot Noir, you also get Cabernet, Merlot, Zinfandel, Syrah. So because of the different soils and the different climates within such a small geographical region, you are able to get so many different grape varieties that do very well.
那 刚才大师介绍的是就是在纳帕谷这个地方，因为它的气候和土壤非常的多变，然后再加上它的这个葡萄品种很多变，所以呢它的葡萄酒的风格是变化多端的。例如这个长相思，你可以感受得到长相思它的这个柑橘味水果会比较多，而且它的酒体呢比较轻盈，而这个霞多丽呢它就会有比较丰富和丰满的一个酒体，而且它会含有很多这个热带水果的风味。那包括这个黑皮诺、赤霞珠梅洛还有仙粉黛，它们的风格都是非常多样的。
So, any other questions? Maybe we can take one more before we start tasting the white wines.
Sure. 那第二个问题呢，来自一位观众，他想知道的是这个纳帕谷比较发达的这个旅游业，对我们当地的这个葡萄酒产业造成了哪些主要的影响。So here is a question about tourism impact we just mentioned before, and this audience want to know what are the main impact that the developed industry of tourism has on Napa Valley's wine industry.
I think tourism is really crucial to the Napa Valley wine industry. And when you talk about even the subject of enotourism, where people go to a place to learn about wine, to try wines, to enjoy wines, to relax and to have a holiday, you think immediately of Napa. In fact, many other regions are trying to copy what Napa Valley has done so well. And you see that millions of people visit Napa Valley. Mm-hmm. And fortunately, it has a city, San Francisco, nearby, where it has an international airport, and it's accessible for many people within the United States as well as internationally. So mm-hmm. the impact, I believe, has been really huge, both for the economy as well as for consumers, because they can go to a place where they can really enjoy and relax and learn about wine mm-hmm. in a very unintimidating, friendly atmosphere.
那这个纳帕谷的旅游业呢，对当地的葡萄酒是有非常重要的影响的。因为这个纳帕谷附近呢，就在南边是那个洛杉矶，那洛杉矶有非常好的基础设施，所以是方便我们的游人呢前往纳帕谷进行参观和学习葡萄酒的相关知识。那其实这个旅游业呢，对于不仅是对于纳帕谷葡萄酒行业有巨大影响，对当地的经济也有非常重要的影响。
So great. I have two wines that I want to show first. First is something that people don't often associate with Napa Valley or even California. It's a Sauvignon Blanc, mm-hmm. which really, made its popularity with New Zealand people who, okay. from Marlborough, they exported Sauvignon Blanc around the world and really made people appreciate that fresh, herbaceous flavor of Sauvignon Blanc.
那今天呢，我们首先要开始品鉴的是两款白葡萄酒。那首先我要为大家介绍的这款白葡萄酒呢是非常特别，因为它并不是那么为人所知，就是这款来自就是这款长相思葡萄酒。这款葡萄酒呢，其实长相思是在这个新西兰非常的受欢迎，因为新西兰的马尔堡这个长相思它有一个非常清新的一个风格。
So the first wine that I have in front of me is the Stone Street Vineyards Sauvignon Blanc. And a lot of Sauvignon Blancs in California mm-hmm. Can be oak-aged, and it's not blended like in Bordeaux yeah. with Semillon. And it's made just with Sauvignon Blanc, but treated almost like a Chardonnay, made in a creamier, rounder, fuller-bodied style. But this is not one of them.This is a vineyard that's owned by the Jackson family, mm-hmm. and it's a style that doesn't see any oak. Mm-hmm. It's probably closer to a New Zealand or a Loire Valley style of Sauvignon Blanc mm-hmm. than a Bordeaux.
Mm-hmm. 那我们第一款的葡萄酒呢，来自这个十街酒庄的长相思干白葡萄酒。那其实大家都知道，这个波尔多白是采用的是长相思和这个萨满龙的这个混酿而成。那这种葡萄酒的风格呢，就是比较饱满，有这种奶油般的质感。而我们这款十街酒庄的白葡萄酒呢，它的这个质地是比较的清新的，它是没有过橡木桶的。那这种风格呢，有点像这种新西兰长相思或者是卢瓦河谷长相思的一个风格。
So this is an estate that's been owned by the Jackson family since 1995, Jess Jackson and his wife. And they make it in a style where most of it, about 70% is fermented in stainless steel. There's freshness, there's lots of citrus, lime, lemon flavors. And you do get some herbs, but they're fresh herbs like chives and parsley, and not grassy, not strong, and not as zingy and as forward as New Zealand.
那这个时间酒庄呢，它的这个庄，它一直是由自1995年起由这个杰森家庭一直经营到现在。那其实它的这个风格呢是偏轻盈的，没有这么多这种青草的气息，而且它会带有一些这个柑橘和这种柠檬的香气，它会有一些些这种矿物质的风格，但是并不是这么明显。
And the reason that they're able to get this freshness and good acidity is because it's mountain fruit. And it's coming from the Mayacamas mountain range, where Stone Street wines are located. And you can see that it's that high acidity, it's the lightness, there's no heaviness, no big concentrated flavors here, and that's exactly what a great Sauvignon Blanc should be, light and easy to enjoy.
那其实这款酒我们刚才提到呢是非常这种清新的风格，为什么呢？是因为这款酒所精选的长相思呢，它生长在这个山上，是这种山地土所孕育出来的这种品种，那这样出来的葡萄酒它会有比较好的或者是较高的酸度，而且酒体比较轻盈，那它的口感不会这么的重，也不会这么的浓缩，那这就是顶级的长相思应该有的风格，就是非常意义。
And the next wine I have here is Fremark Abbey. And this is a Napa Valley Chardonnay. And one thing about Napa Valley Chardonnay as something that's could be big, very ripe, very fruity, tropical fruity. And there is some sweetness here. There's a hint of melon, some peaches, and there is a butteriness, but it's all pretty restrained. And Fremark Abbey has created a Chardonnay, I think, is really more food-friendly, balanced with its acidity as well as its sweet fruits.
那第二款呢是来自这个飞马修道院酒庄的长相思干白葡萄酒。那大家知道这个纳帕谷的长相思的纳帕谷霞多丽的这个风格呢是比较大气、圆润、成熟，而且非常多的这种热带水果的风味。但是这款长相思这款霞多丽呢，它的风格是果味更加的浓郁，而且它的平衡感和酸度都非常好。它虽然内敛，但是它的果味是比较令人印象深刻的。
So this is a very special winery for many reasons. First, it was one of the wineries that was owned at one time by Josephine Tixon, who is the first female winemaker in California. And this is in the 1880s, so very early on. And it was also one of the wines that competed in the 1976 Paris tasting.
Mm-hmm. 那其实这款酒庄的独到之处呢，原因有两个。第一个是，这款酒庄的庄主，就是第一任庄主，其实是一位女性庄主，就是约瑟芬。然后她是在1880年成立了这个酒庄。那第二个独特的原因是，当时在这个巴黎审判上，这一家酒庄的葡萄酒也是拿到了这个盲品会上接受大家的品鉴。
I really appreciate how they didn't use too much oak influence. The oak aging is only for about 5 months rather than the usual 1 year or more sometimes in Burgundy. And it has not gone through malolactic fermentation. And this is a technique that lots of people are using around the world. When you're making wine in a warm climate, you want the wine to have freshness and acidity and a bit of lightness.
Mm-hmm.
And not allowing it to go through the second malolactic fermentation allows you to keep that acidity. And this wine has that freshness, and it isn't heavy. And that's what gives it the balance.
Mm-hmm. 那其实我喜欢这款酒的原因还在于它没有经过橡木桶的熟化，它经过它 他在橡木桶熟化的时间没有这么久，只有大概是五个月左右，而这跟这个勃艮第的白葡萄酒是有一些差别的。那而且这款酒还有一个非常独特的地方是，它没有经过这个苹果酸乳酸的发酵。像在世界的其他地方酿造，特别是温暖的地区，那酿造白葡萄酒的时候，人们都希望能够保持它一个非常清新的一个酸度。但是这个酒庄的独到之处就是在于，即便是在温暖纳帕地区，它也能保持这个霞多丽这种清新的这种酸度，而且它的平衡感会非常好。
So now we tasted two white wines, which really gives you the two major white grape varieties from California. And even though only one is coming from Napa, the Chardonnay, mm-hmm. you can see that Sonoma, which is Napa's neighbor, is really getting well known for a lot of cool climate grape varieties, like Sauvignon Blanc, mm-hmm. like Pinot Noir, and mm-hmm. like Chardonnay. And so we have two wines coming up. One is from Sonoma, and then another is from the coast of California, which is from Santa Barbara.
那接下来呢，我们要品鉴的另外两款葡萄酒呢，是来自纳帕谷的邻居，就是索诺玛县。那索诺玛县这个地方也以冷凉的这个葡萄品种而著称。那当地比较适合当地的生长的葡萄品种有包括这个。黑皮诺，还有这个霞多丽以及长相思。
So, Siduri is a winery that's really interesting. It was started by Adam Lee and Diana Novi, and they were actually from Texas and decided they fell in love with Sonoma and with California, mm-hmm. and they decided to really create a Pinot Noir that reflects this restraint, more Burgundian in style. Mm-hmm. So you'll see that the second Pinot Noir, which is from Russian River, mm-hmm. is a very different style. And this from Santa Rita Hills in Santa Barbara mm-hmm. is a savory, kind of dark fruit, bit more chewier on the tannins, mm-hmm. even though the tannins are still light. Mm-hmm. And it's a style that probably those who really enjoy Pomade in Burgundy, for example, would really love.
那我们第三款葡萄酒呢，是来自这个西杜利酒庄的黑皮诺红葡萄酒。那其实这款酒呢，给人的感觉是有非常好的这个鲜味，而且它的这个深色水果的风味会比较浓郁，单宁虽然没有这么明显，但是非常的有嚼劲感。如果有人会喜欢这个波尔多右岸的波美侯地区的红葡萄酒，那其实这款酒的风格会比较相似。
So what I love about Pinot Noir that's coming out of the cool regions in California is that you get this balance between fruit sweetness as well as the good acidity that you really need to give it the backbone. And of course, it's still going to be light in color as it is in Burgundy, but it's the perfume that really jumps out at you, comes out of the glass, and gives you this alluring feeling that all you want to do is smell the wine all night.
那其实我之所以喜欢这款黑皮诺红葡萄酒的原因，是因为它在凉爽的气候之下，能够生产出非常优质的这个黑皮诺葡萄。那它有非常好的一个平衡感，果味非常的浓郁，它的那个酸度是非常好，而且它的颜色是比较浅。那其实从它的香味呢，你就可以感受得到这款酒的魅力是很大，而且非常的诱人。那 Jeannie 想刚才说，她就只想是 enjoy 这个香气一个晚上。
No, but you want to drink it too.
Okay.
So this is a wine that has lovely dark cherry notes. It's restrained. So although you get good aromas, and they do jump out at you. It's not as aromatic uh-huh. as one would think. There's mm-hmm. a bit of spices. Mm-hmm. And really, it's on the palate that you see that the wine has some sweetness. And the tannins are silky. But like I said, when you compare it with the Pinot Noir from Russian River, it's a little bit firmer. And that's one of the differences.
那这款酒呢 很明显的是一个深色的这种深邃的这种黑樱桃的这种香气，它虽然内敛，但是它的这个香气是非常的优雅的，在口中的感觉是有一种淡淡甜美感，单宁呢是犹如丝绸般的质滑。这款黑皮诺呢产自这个俄罗斯河谷，那其实来自这个地方的黑皮诺呢，它会有一个比较紧实的感觉。
So now we have the next Pinot Noir, which is completely different.Mainly because just on the aroma alone, you get this wild flower aroma. It's one of those Pinot Noirs that I have as a very strong aroma mm-hmm. from the very beginning. So you don't even have to go very close. The flowers, the roses, the dried jasmine flowers, it all kind of jumps out at you. And then on the palate, you have this lovely sweetness, mostly mm-hmm. red fruits like raspberries and strawberries, and then a very gentle tannins. It almost caresses you. So if you're somebody who doesn't like tannins, this Russian River Pinot Noir is perfect for you.
Uh-huh. 那接下来我们要尝试的这一款黑皮诺红葡萄酒呢，它也是非常独特的。为什么呢？是因为在一开始还没喝这款葡萄酒的时候，它的这种野花的香气就会从这个葡萄酒杯中洋溢出来。那其实这里面包含了非常多干花的这种香气，而且在口中的感觉呢，是有非常多红色水果的这种水果风味。同时，这个单宁非常的细致和精致啊。那如果说有人会不喜欢单宁的感觉，这款酒一定是你的首选。
So one of the ways that this wine is a little bit special is that there is this feminine, almost very delicate touch. And it's not surprising because it was started by two women. Mm-hmm. And their names were Barbara Bank and Peggy Firth mm-hmm. in 2006. So it's a very new winery in Russian River Valley. They're not very big, and they're making wines that have this lightness, delicacy, but uh-huh. still wonderful, beautiful aromatics.
Uh-huh. 那为什么这款酒会给人的感觉这么精致呢？就是因为这款酒的庄主是两位女性的酿酒师，他们是这个Barbara 和这个佩吉，那其实他们因为可能是因为女性的关系吧，在制作这个黑皮诺葡萄酒的时候，他们会赋予这款酒更加精致、更加甜美、更加女性的感觉。
So we've tasted four wines now, and before we go on to the two Cabernets from Napa, let's take a few questions.
Okay.
Yeah.
Check.
Okay.
因为我们刚才喝了这个黑皮诺干红葡萄酒，那现在就有这个观众对于黑皮诺会比较感兴趣。那这位观众就问：你是如何看待？问我们大师，你是如何看待这个勃艮第的黑皮诺与这个纳帕谷的黑皮诺的？你认为二者之间最大的区别和相似点是什么？ Well, since we just taste two Pinot Noir, so mm-hmm. one of our audience curious about something about the difference and similarity between the Napa Pinot Noir and the Burgundy Pinot Noir. So mm-hmm. what's the biggest difference and similarities between them?
The biggest difference between Napa or Sonoma Pinot Noir with Burgundy is first the sweetness of the fruit. It's much more obvious in the Californian wines. And this is because it is a warmer region. As we mentioned earlier, the climate and the latitude of where Napa lies, which is around 38 degrees latitude, is very different from Bordeaux, which is at 44, and Burgundy, which is similar as well. So mm-hmm. that means it's a cooler site in Burgundy. So mm-hmm. The body of the wine is also much lighter in mm-hmm. Burgundy mm-hmm. and a bit heavier and thicker and richer in California, in Napa and Sonoma.
Mm-hmm. 那其实大师认为它最大的不同之处是因为当地的这个气候和地理因素造成的。那我们看到这个加州的这个纬度大概是在北纬38度左右，那当地再加上一些地理环境的影响，当地会有比较温暖的一个天气。而这个勃艮第呢是在大概是北纬44度左右，那当地会比较一个 cold 就是凉爽的一个天气。那因此呢，纳帕谷地区的这个黑皮诺它会有比较甜美的感觉，而在勃艮第这个地方它的黑皮诺它的酒体会更加轻盈。
So just to summarize, it's body, bigger body, higher alcohol, sweeter fruits, more richness in the texture of the wine, and a general higher sweetness.
For Napa wine, yes. 那也就是说这个纳帕葡萄，纳帕谷的黑皮诺葡萄酒呢，它的风格会更加大气，酒精度会更加高，这个红色水果的风味会，红色水果的这个风味会更加突出，而且它在口感的感觉会比较的丰富。
So I would recommend if you like generous wines and you like sweeter wines, then Napa Pinot or Sonoma Pinot would probably be more suitable for you. And if you like wines that are lighter, more elegant, more restrained, a little bit higher in acidity, then you go for the Burgundy.
那如果是你喜欢这种大气的这种酒的感觉，更甜美的酒的感觉，那大师会比较推荐这个纳帕的葡萄酒，或者索诺玛的这个黑皮诺葡萄酒。但是如果你喜欢更加高酸一点的感觉，或者是更轻盈一点的质地，那会推荐这个勃艮第的黑皮诺。Okay,
should we take another question?
Okay. So this audience wants to know what advantages do American wines, especially Napa wines, boast when compared with wines from the other New World countries?
Ah, that's a very good question because I think Napa Valley wines are known to be quite expensive. And people ask why. Why are they more expensive than wines from Chile or Argentina or South Africa or Australia? And it is often true. I think let's talk about the uniqueness first and then the price second.
Okay.
So what makes Napa very different is that there's been considerable investment in the vineyard, the winemaking, and also the price of the land.
Okay.
Because of its proximity to San Francisco and Silicon Valley.
那其实我们会注意得到为什么你会看到这个纳帕葡萄酒的价格会高于其他新世界产酒国，比如说这个智利或者南美葡萄酒的价格呢？ 那我们接下来会解释到，首先我们要解释它之所以价格高，是因为它有非常独特的这个原因。首先是在于当地的葡萄酒行业在葡萄园和这个酿酒技术甚至土地上投资其实是非常多的。So
I think also what makes Napa so different and unique is that it is actually owned by families, as we mentioned. So they're very small. The quantity that they make is very small. And because there is such a big demand in the United States for top quality California wines, especially from Napa, the prices have gone up. And so you have both great investment, lots of care, and meticulous attention to detail by family members and people who care about the final product. And then the popularity and demand side, which combined together has progressed in terms of quality of the wine as well as the price of the wine.
那其实还有一个独到之处，刚才我们提及到了，是因为纳帕谷这个地方的酒庄多为是这种小型的家庭经营酒庄。那其实这种小型家庭经营酒庄的酒的年产量其实它也是非常小的，而 对于美国而言，这个美国市场非常追求这种高品质的葡萄酒，因此在这种家庭酒庄精心照料并且培育的葡萄，照料之下，它所种植的葡萄和酿造的这种葡萄酒，它的品质是十分出色的。那精心的照料，那大量的市场需求也推动了纳帕谷葡萄酒价格的增长。
So I hope that makes it, pretty clear why Napa is pretty unique and what makes both the quality and the price so high right now.
Yeah.
And I think it's a perfect time to taste two Napa Valley Cabernets.
Okay. 那现在呢？ 我们刚刚解释完这个问题之后，可能有点觉得口渴，大师觉得，所以说我们现在要品鉴的是后两款来自纳帕谷地区的这个赤霞朱红葡萄酒。那其实红酒世界在纳帕谷这个地方，3月份的时候，也会举行一个红酒马拉松，大家可以关注一下。
So I have two wines, two Cabernets, in front of me. And I wanted to make sure that we tasted a wine that's more from a very classic, what you called the Rutherford Bench and the Valley Floor area, compared to the second Cabernet, which is from the mountain, Spring Mountain.
所以呢，我们现在品鉴的两款赤霞珠呢，是两个非常不同的一个风格，一个是非常经典的，另外一个是来自山地的一个山地上生长的赤霞珠的一个风格。
So both of these wines are from the 2012 vintage. This first one that I have in front of me is the 2012 Aiken Cabernet Sauvignon from Rutherford in Napa Valley. And what makes Rutherford one of the most expensive and also the most iconic regions in Napa. Even within Napa, I think Rutherford and Oakville are the two regions that everybody turns to for the silkiest, the most elegant, and also the most sought after wines. And this Aiken Cabernet is a very good example of the Rutherford land and the Rutherford dust.
Okay. 那这款酒呢，来自是2012年的这个艾肯卢瑟福这个赤霞珠干红葡萄酒。那其实，卢瑟福这个产区在美国是比较受欢迎的，因为当地呢非常追捧这种有这种丝绸般的质感的葡萄酒。那这款葡萄酒给人感觉也是非常的优雅，而且受到了很多人的欢迎。
So what Rutherford is really well known for is having these firm but very velvety, supple tannins with a finish that they call is reminiscent of Rutherford dust. A slight dustiness, but fine-grained, and it's something that lingers on your palate. You can call it earthiness, you can call it dustiness, but Rutherford Cabernets especially embody what the best Cabernets can produce from Napa Valley.
那这个卢瑟福这个地方呢，它的赤霞珠给人的感觉是比较紧致，而且有天鹅绒般的质感。那它在余味当中会有一些些紧致的感觉，会有一些些可以说是陈的味道，或者是矿物或者是土壤的风味。但是这种香气会一直在残留在你的这个口齿之间。那其实这个是非常优质的赤霞珠干红葡萄酒的一个表现。
So this winery, Aiken, was started by Joel Aiken, who was the vice president of winemaking at one of the most historic and oldest wineries in Napa Valley, Beaulieu Vineyard. And he started this really only in 2009, so it's a very young winery. And you can see that there's great potential here. And Aiken knows definitely what he's doing, and I'm sure that he'll continue to be more successful.
那这个其实这个艾肯酒庄呢，其实也是非常年轻的一个酒庄，它成立于2009年。那他们家的这个酿酒师也是非常有才华，而且你可以看到这款酒其实是非常有潜力的。那大师相信，如果说这个艾肯酒庄保持这样一个水准，那未来它的品质可能会越来越好。
And on my right, I have here Jocelyn Vineyards Cabernet Sauvignon.And this is mountain fruit. It's from Spring Mountain. And what you notice immediately on the palate, the difference between the two, is that the Spring Mountain fruit is definitely firmer on the tannins. Tannins are firm, almost chewy, but not in an unpleasant way, in a way that you feel like you want a piece of steak.
那最后一款酒呢，是来自这个嘉陵酒庄的赤霞珠干红葡萄酒。这款酒的酿酒葡萄呢，是在这个山地生长的，它是选自于这个春山区的葡萄。那这款酒给人的口感呢，是它的单宁是很紧致，而且是有嚼劲，但是这种感觉让人觉得是非常的愉悦的一个感觉。
So what I love about this story is that.Very typical of Napa Valley. It was started by British expats, a couple who was in high tech. And they decided, they fell in love with wine and retired in 97 and bought this very small property. It's only 3.2 hectares, very small. And devoted themselves to making really high quality Cabernet. Mm-hmm. And this is a typical story that you'll find everywhere in Napa Valley, where you have families that just want to put their passion and love into a small project, and it's really handcrafted. And I taste in this wine amazing finesse as well as concentration.
Mm-hmm. 那这款酒呢会有一个非常好的集中的感，集中度。那其实这个酒庄的故事也是非常有意思的。那这种这个艾肯酒庄的这个哦，嘉陵酒庄的这个故事也是发生在纳帕谷很多酒地区的。也就是这个酒庄，这是一对夫妇在从事这个IT业。 退休之后决定将他们的这种对于葡萄酒的热爱投入到现实当中，他们就建立了自己的酒庄，在这个小小的葡萄园上，精心酿造了这种高品质的葡萄酒。So
I'm in love with this Jocelyn Vineyard Cabernet Sauvignon. I can drink it all day, all night. And it's because I love that juxtaposition of great concentration. I can also see that it has a great aging potential. I would say at least 20 years easily. And it's only 2012, so 5 years old, a baby right now. And you can imagine it getting even better with time.
那其实大家也看出来，大师对于这款酒是非常非常的喜欢的。那之所以这么喜欢，是因为当然刚才我们说到，一个是它的这种集中度，还有一个是它的这种陈年潜力会非常好。那其实呢，这款酒呢是2012年份的，那其实它只有5年左右的一个酒龄。那在未来的时间当中，10年20年，那这款酒会发展得更好。
So I think we have time for a few more questions.
Yeah.
So,
那现在在我们品鉴完之后，我们会有一些问题要问到大师。所以第一个问题，纳帕的赤霞珠葡萄酒非常的有名，有与波尔多相比，是与波尔多的赤霞珠葡萄酒相比，其优势在哪里？So Napa is so famous for its Cabernet Sauvignon, and what's its strength compared with that of Bordeaux?
Well, the strength of Napa Valley is that you don't have as much vintage variation as in Bordeaux. So Bordeaux, a vintage from 2010 to 2011 was huge, and every 1 or 2 years out of a decade in Bordeaux, you have very difficult, challenging vintage because of the climate. And the weather conditions, which is often rainy during harvest. And Napa doesn't have that. It's actually unusual for Napa to have a really terrible vintage.
Okay. 那其实最大的一个不同之处是在于这个年份。其实这个波尔多由于它气候的多变，因此这个年份的变化是非常大的。举个例子，10年和11年两个年份，它就是非常不同的风格。而在这个纳帕地区，它的年份呢，其实比较保持一个稳定的水准。
So the other difference is for people who really want more concentrated, full-bodied, very rich styles, and Napa, because of its warmer climate, it's a Mediterranean climate, it produces more richness, higher alcohol, more body, and very often rich, voluptuous, dense, concentrated flavors, which many people in the United States really love and around the world.
优势是在于是，不论是美国人还是全世界的人都会比较青睐这种，华美啊这种饱满酒体的感觉。那因此，由于纳帕地区这个温暖的气候，当地的这个葡萄酒有更加丰满的感觉，而且它的酒精度会比较高，因此对它的酒体呢就会更加的饱满。
One of the questions people ask is Napa Valley wines as age-worthy? Can you age them as long as Bordeaux? And I'd say I've had some amazing Inglenook from 1940s and 1950s. Wonderful, amazing Beaulieu Vineyard, Georges de la Tour, Cabernet Sauvignon from the 60s. And the 70s were a great decade for everyone in Napa Valley. So, and they're drinking well now, even. So there is no question that the best Napa Valley reds can age for a very long time.
那其实有人也会问到这个纳帕谷葡萄酒的这个陈年潜力相比起波尔多是怎么样的？其实大师认为这个纳帕谷葡萄酒的陈年潜力也是相当棒的。那大师本人可能有收藏到比如说40年、50年的葡萄酒，现在再打开来喝，包括是60、70年的葡萄酒，现在打开来喝还是非常的令人惊艳的。
We can take one last question.
Okay. Here's an interesting question. 那其实春节的快到了，于是就是有人会问到说，春节的快到了，今年的家庭聚餐我想是一点不一样的东西。今晚的几款美国酒中有哪一款是比较适合年夜饭的？希望我们大师能推荐一下。So the Chinese Lunar New Year is around the corner,
oh, yes.
And I want to try something new in our family reunion dinner this year. So which wine tonight you would like to recommend?
I have to recommend two, I think.
Okay.
I can't recommend just one.
Uh-huh.
So for a white wine, I would definitely recommend the Freemark Abbey Napa Valley Chardonnay, which will go with so many different seafood dishes or vegetables and, you know, any kind of stir-fried lighter foods.
那大师会比较推荐两款葡萄酒，第一款是来自于这个飞马酒庄的霞多丽干白葡萄酒，因为这款酒呢和这个比较轻盈的食物，例如说海鲜或者蔬菜会比较搭配。
So this is the Chardonnay I would choose, and for the red, I would have to choose the one that I keep drinking is the Jesslyn Vineyard Spring Mountain Cabernet Sauvignon. There is actually some Cabernet Franc and Merlot in this wine, so it's a blend, although majority is Cabernet Sauvignon. It's a perfect match with any kind of barbecue roasted meats and any beef or mutton or lamb dishes.
那红葡萄酒呢，大师是一定会推荐这款嘉陵的红葡萄酒的。这款葡萄酒由梅洛和赤霞珠混酿而成，是对于红肉来讲是一个非常好的搭配。Yeah, so I think almost time, right?
Yes.
那其实很高兴今天再次跟大家在这里聊聊葡萄酒这些事情。因为这个红酒世界在今年三月份会举行一个在纳帕谷的马拉松。那如果您对这个纳帕谷葡萄酒感兴趣的话，也可以关注一下我们这个活动。当然，因为新年将至，而且我们今天的主题是有关于美国葡萄酒，因此红酒世界也推出了一个优惠活动。现在呢，从现在开始一直到1月25日，那在我们的红酒世界商城上，美国酒的全场呢是有买299减10买599减30的一个优惠活动。那今天时间过得很快，然后感谢李大师也给我们分享了这么多有关于葡萄酒的内容。那我们今天就到这里。 So I think it's time we should say goodbye to our audience.
Yes, and even though it's a little early, I'd like to say Happy New Year, 新年快乐。
Yeah, 那在这里给大家拜一个早年。 So bye.
Bye.